Now, I the last scene, first off, I would just want to say that I think every American should go see this movie because it really puts in perspective what these guys do for us every day and how they literally put it on the line. And there are threats out there that we don't even hear about, we don't even know about. And they put their lives on the line to make sure that we can get up and go to work and we can do things like be on the radio and have fun and make movies and do what we do.
It's absolutely correct. And, you know, so many times the movies portray the military in such a negative light. And this one is truly a testament to not just being an American, just being a great human being. Right. And understanding that, you know, all of what we enjoy, these guys protect.
Right. Exactly. You couldn't have said it any better. And also, too, the final scene in this film, I'll tell you, I saw it opening night, and I was in a crowded theater. I mean, there was not a seat in the theater. And that, I'm not going to give it away, but I will tell you that two things happened. Number one, you could hear sniffles throughout the whole back of the theater. You just hear.
Yeah.
And number two, everybody sat through the credits. Nobody got up until the lights came up.
No, I know. It was extraordinary. I mean, I thought opening weekend I went to like six shows, and at one point at the when the crawl comes up of the fallen,
mm-hmm.
like
right.
60 people stood up in
wow.
the audience, which
wow.
I knew they were military based, right?
Yeah,
when they
yeah.
were they stood up during that crawl, and then when the movie ended, everyone gave it a standing ovation. I mean, I've never seen that in a movie theater.
No.
I've seen that at like cast and crew screenings,
right.
but not in, you know, a theater in Thousand Oaks.
Yeah. See, that's you guys, you have done such an amazing job with this film. And everybody with me was so impressed. I went with my son and my nephews and stuff. And I said that, you know, I said, I wanted to get you on the air and interview you and get inside, you know, because I make films too, and I'm shooting now with a PMW EX-1, and I have a Canon 550D. And
uh-huh.
I was wondering, how did you get that big cinema look out of such small cameras? You know, you could usually tell, like in the beginning of the film, you could tell what's shot with a video camera, and you can shot, like I shoot in 24p, and you know, use the gamma, the cinema gamma, and all that. But how did you get it to fill the 235 aspect and fill the screen like that?
Well, I mean, truly, you know, it was kind of a roller coaster ride for me, you know, in a visual sense, because I was truly, you know, I was figuring out this camera. I mean, the camera had only been out about 4 months and no one had really, you know, done anything like we were trying to do with it. They were making like little web, you know, little infomercials and stuff like that,
right.
little short films on it, but nothing, nobody was putting in it. They were putting on a 15-inch laptop, not a 60-foot screen.
Right.
And, you know, I just kind of, my whole, you know, mentality is, what is going to tell the story the best?
Mm-hmm.
What is going to immerse the audience and transport them in a new way? And that was the Canon 5D. So it didn't, to me, the visual style was trying to take that small little camera and give it the cinematic big image, you know, monster screen kind of feel. And, you know, it started off as like a ton of tests with Jacob Rosenberg, who's the head of post-production at Bandito Brothers, and just kind of sending it through different channels to be able to unlock more information out of that, you know, highly compressed codec.
Right.
And then Cinefilm came to me via my blog. They called me up, and they had been a huge advocate of the Hurl blog, and they said, you know, we have this new technology. We need you to sign an NDA. And, you know, I signed the NDA, and they basically said, we have something that's going to take your 5D footage and do things to it you never thought were possible. And I'm like, well, what's that? And they're like, well, you see all that compression? I'm like, yeah. He goes, how about it's all gone? I'm like, okay, that's kind of cool. And then he's like, all right, now out of the same logarithm that I just vaporized your compression, I'm now going to infuse grain texture on top of it. So once I started to see this process, I just knew I would be able to cross-cut, you know, 35-millimeter film and 5D all day. And that was kind of the icing on the cake to, you know, just taking, you know, lighting the footage and shooting the footage in a way that, you know, I've been doing this for 16 years, so the experience behind the camera, you know, taking this small little CMOS sensor and really giving it life, and then, you know, adding the post process of being able to slide this grain texture and getting rid of, you know, all the compression was like the secret little recipe.
Oh, okay. So you did kind of contract that out. I'm trying to figure out, geez, how did he run it through some kind of filter, or what did he, After Effects or what?
No, it's called the Dark Energy. And that's what their system is.
How did cooperative was the military? Did they have to see the film before it was released? Did they nay anything that you did or wanted to do, et cetera?
They scrubbed every bit of footage we ever shot. It was pretty amazing. Captain Duncan Smith, who was our kind of our liaison to the Navy, came by for weeks on end and scrubbed every ounce of footage.
Wow. Yeah, they didn't want to make sure you didn't give away any technical information or their tactical information.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. Now, I have a question for you. There's a lot of halo jumps that take place in the film. Were you the DP on the actual halo jumps?
Oh, are you crazy?
So you must have rigged up one of the guys and just said, here, just put the camera on those guys, right?
Jim was one of our leapfrogs. And SEAL leapfroggers. And, you know, we kind of discussed the whole aerial flight and them doing the halo jumps and all that kind of stuff and when the best time to shoot it, what type of light, exposures. And, you know, he just jumped out of there and, you know, he's a professional. And I wanted somebody that does this for a living and does it very well. And I think if I would have jumped out of there, first off, I would have freaked out for the first 5,000 feet and missed all the really great shit. No, Jim did an amazing job and, you know, really brought to life aerial photography that I've really never seen in movies before. You know, everyone does it green screen and blue screen, and you know, again, we wanted to be legit and real, and we, you know, we just went for it.
I wish you were doing the Bin Laden movie.
Jeez.
Early on in the interview, I don't want to take up all your time. When you were mentioning the whole relationship marketing thing, there's kind of an idea, kind of a business model film thing that I'd like to talk to you about further. But you know, we could do that at another time.
Okay.
I could give you my contact information, but it's kind of like along the lines of that, and I can go into that a little bit deeper on our own off the air. Do you ever get back to the East Coast at all?
Yeah, I was just in D.C. Doing a whole talk on Act of Valor on the 22nd of February, which went very well. That was a really fun event. We had like 400-some-odd people, and we rented a theater. And we did, you know, I did a case study on Act of Valor, and Jacob Rosenberg kind of went into the whole post process, and then we did a Q&A and watched the film.
Beautiful.
So it was a lot of fun. But yeah, I'm constantly going back and forth. I was in New York just before that, shooting Game of Thrones promos for HBO. So you know, I'm always kind of.
Well, next time you're in New York City, I'd love to take you to lunch and pick your brain.
Oh, yeah, I'd love that.
No, you've gotten very positive response from veterans and people that are actually serving?
Yes, you know, the response has been really great to all the people in the military. They just really have embraced this film as something that they found was finally a realistic depiction of not only tactical but also their lives with their wives, with their families, deployments, that vicious cycle that their family goes through. It just really rang true to everyone.
Well, I would think that they would be probably the hardest critics to please, and you did that, so you can say you've been successful.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with that.
I think the whole project has been a tremendous success all the way around, from you to everybody involved in that film. And like I said it before, and I can't say it enough again, I think every American should see this film. It's an amazing story. It's technically it's spot on, and it's just everybody involved just did such an awesome job. And you're great, Shane. Thank you so much for calling in and sharing your time with us.
Favorite 80s bands? 80s bands. You got a couple of them?
Oh, yeah. I mean, AC/DC was probably one of my favorite 80s bands. Def Leppard, REO Speedwagon.
Oh, you're right up. You're right on our format there, buddy.
Oh, my God. When I was in high school, we used to run REO Speedwagon, that Nine Lives.
Oh, yeah, I remember it.
Yep.
You know, album. That was like our entrance song into the basketball games when you'd come out of the tunnel.
Ah, okay. That's awesome.
Oh, it was so much fun. We had that. We had AC/DC. I must have gone to like 6 or 7 AC/DC concerts back in the day. My wife, Lydia, who was, we were high school sweethearts, she loved AC/DC as well. And so we were like, you know, metalheads during the 80s together. We loved all that stuff.
What's your favorite AC/DC song?
Shoot the Thrill.
Yeah. That makes sense of what you do.
Fantastic.
Yeah, you know, that song has just such a driving beat at the beginning, and I love the lyrics. And, you know, it just has a great, I mean, there's tons of other ones, but that one I really... All right, thank you guys.
All righty, talk to you soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Too many women, too many.